IVF, we all know, is never a 100% success, right? There is a failure rate attached to it. So whenever a patient has a failed IVF, the next question that comes is that, what next, doctor? What is an IVF process? Once you are diagnosed with infertility and your infertility doctor suggests IVF, then normally you will be put under gonadotropin injections from day two of cycle, that is ovarian stimulation. Your eggs are retrieved, fertilized with husband's sperms, maybe IVF, maybe ICSI, IMSI. And then when the embryos are formed, they are transferred in the same cycle fresh, day three, or blastocyst, or all frozen and transferred in the next cycle as a frozen embryo transfer. Wait for 2 weeks, and that 2 week wait is a real stress, and you get your beta HCG result, which will indicate whether it's successful or whether it's not successful. If we look at the statistics, we find that number of cycles are increasing day by day, and millions of babies have been born through IVF. And worldwide, at least 7 million IVF cycles only from Australia, New Zealand, Canada, Europe, USA, Japan, Latin America is found. So imagine the other countries where it has started everywhere in the number of cycles. Success rate on an average, it could vary from couple to couple. Older the age of egg, the lower the success, younger the couple, and just an indication of low sperm count, maybe higher a result. Uterine problems are not there, higher result. So what is the average success rate? If we say that 35% we considered as a fact, like considering all the various group of couples, then at least we always, when we start the IVF cycle, based on their success rate, we'll tell them that it could be one cycle, two cycle, three cycle. On an average, we counsel for three. If the older age, we can say that we'll check your eggs, we'll do the fertilization. If we do not have embryos, maybe the second cycle, we do something differently, rejuvenation, and then do it. Or in the end, may suggest gamete donation in the form of egg or sperm. Or if the uterus is issue, we can find out. So first IVF cycle is successful for 35%, yes. But for the other 65%, it's not a waste. It will tell us that what is the problem. We can identify also a problem, that what goes wrong, whether the embryos are not forming, or they are not good quality, eggs are granulated, or they do not reach to blastocyst. All these things we can know with the first cycle. But yes, when it fails, it causes a lot of distress to the couples. And I would say not only couples, even the doctors are equally frustrated. Most common question, what went wrong, doctor? All our reports are normal. Then where is the problem? What will happen now? Will my second IVF be successful? Failed IVF means I'm never going to have a baby. How to cope with IVF failure? Is it my fault? Did I do something wrong after the transfer? Will I ever conceive again? Is it the egg or the sperm? Or how much do I have to wait again to start a treatment? And so many questions, and I understand that, yes, it is justified that the patients will have a battery of questions, and we should be patiently answering it. So why does an IVF cycle fail? It could be the uterus. It could be the embryo, that is the egg and the sperm, or it could be some problem with the embryo transfer procedure also. And the main factors that affect the success or failure of IVF is the age of the female partner, because age of the egg decides the quality, sperm quality, embryo quality. Then the IVF lab where you are doing it, it should have an experienced embryologist, an experienced clinical team, clinic with advanced techniques. The IVF, which started 4 decades back, is a very, very different IVF from now, where so many techniques have come up now to give the best outcome. Then what was the cause? Was it a bad endometriosis, or where the uterine fibroids were removed, so there was some uterine issue? Or is there a genetic factor affecting the quality of the egg, or there is a chromosomal abnormality, and definitely the immunological factors. We all know that maternal age plays a very important role. Higher the age, more the abnormal or aneuploid eggs and abnormal embryos. So definitely the pregnancy rate goes down. And this is the burning question right now, because we are seeing lots and lots of females who would delay the childbearing. And that is the modern family, unfortunately, without the awareness that at least the eggs could be frozen. And if you look at the success rate here, younger the patient, the euploid embryos are more, and aneuploid, that is the abnormal embryos, is just 30% or less than 30% between 20 to 32. But then it starts rising, and by the time you are 40, at least 60% to 80% of your embryos are abnormal. So that means you will have abnormal embryo and no implantation or a failure. So when you use egg donors, at least we know that 61% of the embryos will be normal. But when your eggs are less than 35, at least 48% normal blastocyst, which reduces to 44, 33, and finally it is just 11% beyond the age of 42. And percentage of transfers that resulted in live birth from fresh embryos using own eggs and fresh embryos using from donor eggs by the age of the woman. So if you look at the age of the woman, from 24 to 34, you can see the percentage of success was definitely 40 to 50%. But after the age of 36, 38, it comes down. And by the time you are 40, the success rate was just 30%. But the same female, if she used donor egg, her success rate was again 50 to 60%. The same patient at 42, she had just 10% chance. But with donor egg, it is 50 to 60%. Chance. So this implies that the age of the egg is very, very, very important factor when you are considering the result of the IVF cycle. Lifestyle factors are also equally important. Higher the BMI, obese patients, male and female both, will have an impact on the IVF results. So reducing the weight is a very good idea. Smoking, alcohol consumption, definitely stop it 3 months prior. Stress, avoid it. Do your best, but remove that stress. Ultimately, it is your efforts, doctor's efforts, and finally, the blessings from Almighty who can help us. Disturb sleeping patterns. That also impacts your reproductive environment. Unhealthy diet, junk food, consumption of tobacco, everything should be stopped. Now, let us look at the most frequent causes of unsuccessful treatment. We have talked about the embryo abnormality, because this can be because of a poor ovarian response, even in a young patient, unhealthy lifestyle, severe male factor, chromosomal disorders, then there could be endometrial receptivity and abnormalities, and coagulation and immunological disorders. So your cycle has failed. Now we need to analyze this cycle and find out that what went wrong. You yourself would not know what went wrong. So it is a discussion of the couple with the treating doctor and of course with the embryologist. This is the key person we should also discuss. As a protocol, all our couples will meet the embryologist when the cycle has failed. The first cycle will teach us. We have to learn some lessons from that and we have to change that. And that will come only when all of you come together and discuss what went wrong. Doctor, was it the egg? The embryologist said, no, the egg was really perfect, all M2, excellent. Sperm, yes, the sperms were mostly abnormal. There was no motility. I did activation. I used calcium ionophore. So now we have to work on the sperms. Or the embryos did not grow from this to this stage. Maybe you have to check on the male factors, furthermore tests, or on the female. The doctor will say, yes, the stimulation protocol was a little bit different. I think I should use next time. I went a little lower on dose. I went a little higher on dose. Say that, okay, what did I do wrong? Maybe I did not take the precautions which were told, or maybe I jumbled up in taking the injections, not the correct timings, or I was too stressed. All these things will help us analyze and what needs to be done next to improve the egg, to improve the sperm, and the lab technologies that also can be used differently. And finally, how to take care of the uterus. So eggs improve the quality. If nothing is helping, donation. Male factor improve the sperm quality. I'll tell you how, non-sperm donation. If it was a day three, could we go for blastocyst culture? Then we had not done a pre-implantation genetic testing, let us do it. For the endometrium repeated failure, we can go for ERA test. One failure and we feel we need to do a hysteroscopy or a Receptiva test. Immunological and coagulation tests and further advanced tests like KIR, HLA, NK cells. Poor egg quality could be inherent, especially in advanced stage, or it could be some genetic problem like FSH receptor polymorphism, LH receptor, now the tests are available, or there was something which didn't go right with the stimulation. There could be that we started with a lower dosage, we went for the urinary gonadotrophins, let us try the recombinant gonadotrophins. We went for a higher dosage, so a lot of granulation was seen. We should start with a lower dosage next time. Maybe the trigger we gave was just an LGNRH agonist and it did not act. We need to give a dual trigger because we got a lot of eggs that were GV, germinal and mature, were just one or two. So let us try double trigger, then duostim. There are so many different things that we can discuss you. Previously, when the stimulation was done, it was a blanket protocol. Start with 225, this drug doesn't make a difference. No. Individualized controlled ovarian stimulation. You cannot go for a blanket stimulation for each and everyone. If you have somebody just looking at the software and deciding no. There are so many factors that we look at, from age to BMI to past performance, whether there is endometriosis, PCO, any ovarian surgery done, whether the patient had any history of previous miscarriage. So many things we look into it and then decide the injections. So that is important. When we are transferring the embryo, again we decide, should we go for day two, day three, blastocyst, should we go for fresh, should we go for frozen, should we, if we are going for frozen, should we add one more dose of progesterone, one less dose of progesterone, how we should do it. Should we go for a post-thaw culture transfer rather than just thawing and waiting for 2 hours? So this is a customized IVF with customized luteal phase support. And each cycle will tell us what different we should do next time. And it is your duty to ask your doctor that, what do you think from this cycle? How differently, after how many months I should be doing it? And are you doing the same thing or you're doing something different? If so, why? So this is very important when you are going for this. Nowadays, we also see the role of regenerative medicine in treatment of female infertility. And with our experience, which is we are one of the pioneers and we have seen excellent results and improvement in certain group of patients. You see the human ovary, it has got the stem cells oogonia over here. Normally, the eggs get exhausted or are not good qualities, high apoptotic, even young girls having low AMH. One, their eggs may be reduced in quantity, age decides the quality, but these patients may have little apoptotic bad eggs. So best thing is to do an ovarian rejuvenation, wherein we take the blood of the patient and we create platelet-rich plasma from that and inject it in the ovaries transvaginally. Excuse me. Or we take the bone marrow cells and have the concentrate of cells from that and inject it either laparoscopically, or inject it transvaginally. So we have got excellent outcomes out of this. We do not promise a success to all. It depends on the age. It depends on the... excuse me for my bad cold today. And this is the first patient. They both were homeopathic doctors. They had one miscarriage. The AMH was, you can see, very, very low, 0.3. What did we advise? We said, don't go for IUI or any treatment immediately. We just do an ovarian rejuvenation, healthy lifestyle. We did this in Feb. They came in May. We did it and they had a positive pregnancy. This baby was delivered. And imagine, second time she's naturally pregnant. Similarly, this female was 34 years, 38 years husband, 2 IVF in UK. Both the times there was 2 PN arrest. So age wasn't that bad. AMH wasn't that bad, but her embryos did not reach to even day 3. They were advised donor eggs and they approached us for ovarian rejuvenation as they wanted their own eggs. We did that in the month of August. Then she went back to UK with the plan of doing an IVF cycle in the month of March. She returned on 5th March. 6th was a period's date to start the IVF injection. She never got period. She had conceived naturally and she delivered a baby girl. This is something which is very new, but it is giving good results. We have our first positive case with this. This is known as ovarian tissue activation. Can you see the size of this ovary? It is so small. The AMH so low. What we do? We literally remove that cortex which I showed you in the picture. We take this out and give it in the lab. This is laparoscopic surgery. In the lab, the embryologist will cut it into small slices, that is physical disrupting of the signals, hyposignaling. And then the same laparoscopic setting, it will be put back into the ovary tissue, that is autotrophic, or it can be put just beneath the ovary, which is the heterotrophic transplantation. And immediately 1 month later, this patient can be stimulated to do IVF. So generally, we prefer to do OTA on one side and ovarian rejuvenation on the next side. So this particular patient, I would talk about this patient. She was 35 years of age. Her AMH was 0.35 in April 19th. We advised her ovarian tissue activation, which we did. Latest AMH in December 20 was 0.82. Because of COVID, she never reported in the month of, in the year of 2020, and the rest of the time she had some issues or planning naturally. We planned IVF in January. Fresh ET was done. We got 3 embryos and we transferred all 3. She had a positive result, and now we have also seen the heartbeat in the single live intrauterine pregnancy. This particular technology comes from Denmark and also done in Japan, and we are the first ones to do in India. Now, male factor. We were concentrating off the female, but we know that 50% male is also responsible for all the results in IVF. So IMC, DFI, we check the, when we do the ICSI, we magnify the sperm to 7,000 times and check whether it's normal, because many men have abnormal sperm. We check the DFI. If the DFI is more than 50%, we go for TESA, and we also do testicular rejuvenation. The DNA fragmentation index, you should ask. Sperm motility count, morphology is not enough, especially when you have diabetes, obesity, alcohol, smoking, excessive gymming, environmental toxins, etc. So when the results you don't get, and especially from day 3 to day 5 embryo is not formed, go for DFI. If it is higher than 50%, use only testicular sperms. If it is less than 50%, 25 to 50, do magnetic sorting, where the abnormal DFI sperms will be thrown out and only normal will be taken. We insist for high DNA fragmentation test, especially when who have poor quality embryos, fertilization is failed, repeated miscarriages, or when the eggs are good, but still we don't get good quality embryos. Direct testicular sperm aspiration, because the maximum DNA fragmentation of the sperm occurs when it's getting ejaculated. So such patients can also suggest to go for TESA or PISA and then fertilize the egg. Now, testicular rejuvenation is also what we do. Male factor, they count abnormality very low, their motility is very low, not improving. Then we take the bone marrow derived cells and inject it directly into the testes beneath the scrotal skin and right inside the testicular tissue. We see that it doesn't get very hardened, because otherwise it can get necrotic. This particular patient never had a pregnancy. Her wife was totally healthy. Ultimately, she had to go for donor eggs because her age advanced. There also, the blastocyst formation was not there. After testicular regeneration, we got this, and she has delivered a healthy baby almost 3 years back. So for low sperm count, it is experimental, but still it is very helpful for patients who are not giving good quality sperms and good quality embryo. Let us look at the uterus. Pre-IVF hysteroscopy for all, I would say not all, but for many. Because first IVF, there is no history of any surgery and the endometrial lining goods, no history of any menstrual disturbance, there is no fibroid, nothing, you don't do it. But second cycle, definitely I would want to go for a pre-IVF hysteroscopy if the first has failed, embryo is good, everything, because it's always better to go inside and check everything. Of course, for other diseases, you need to do it. Now, there are certain patients who will not develop endometrium. Whenever you go for the transfer, the doctor will keep saying that your embryos are good, but see, your lining is not going beyond 6. How will I plan a transfer? You will never get a baby. So what we do for thin endometrium also, intrauterine instillation of PRP, subendometrial hysteroscopically PRP or bone marrow, and directly inject the bone marrow into the uterine artery, spiral arterioles. So this is just like an IUI procedure where 2 to 8 days before embryo transfer or IUI, we collect the blood of the patient, from that platelet-rich plasma is released and that is injected, and then about 0.5 ml, and then the patient comes for embryo transfer or IUI. Hysteroscopically also, when there is a persistent thin endometrium and when you feel that there are adhesions which keep coming back, or when the uterine flow is very scanty, that time we do a hysteroscopy. We clean up the adhesions or, and like this, in 4 walls, we inject the PRP so that the next time the lining is good. And this is the first time and world second time where bone marrow was aspirated and then the bone marrow cells were concentrate were created in 1.5 hours culture, and the same day in 1.5 hours after testing for infectious disease, these are the cells, the lovely bone marrow cells. These are injected directly in a cath lab through the femoral artery, going to the uterine artery and injecting at the base of the endometrium in the spiral arterioles. This particular patient was told to go for surrogacy because of tuberculosis. Her lining never developed. She had 3 failed IVF cycles. So she came to us and we told us that this is the first time we are doing this procedure, if you agree. So this is the OT, operation theater, where the bone marrow is taken. This is the stem cell lab where the cell concentrate is created. And this is the cath lab where we inject the stem cells right into the femoral artery going into the uterine artery spiral arterioles. We did the first cycle before that. After that, in the first cycle itself, she conceived in May, embryo transfer, and a healthy baby was born last year, February. This is another female. She had her IVF done in Bangalore. 7 embryos were lying for 1 year. Every time her doctor said that your lining is not up to the mark, your lining is not, because she had a history of fibroid and myomectomy, fibroid removal was done. In the lockdown, she came to our clinic because her husband stays here, and she said, I'm here for 3-4 months till the lockdown goes out, is opened up. What should I do? I said, if your endometrium is not growing, I would suggest we do this procedure. We did that. She went back in July to Bangalore, and the doctor was surprised to see that the lining was very well developed.
I don't know. Maybe it's too much difference. Projection when it is the upper limb. Okay. We were the lower limb.
Okay, sir. So the doctor also called me to find out that what did the doctor, lining was never developing, and he said he did the upper limb. In the cath lab, they put it down.
There are projection when it is.
Subendometrial uterine. Now, endometrial receptivity assay. Normally, implantation is you have the embryo good, lining good, but there is a window of implantation, 2 to 2.5 days, and that is the time when it should be put into the uterus. You could be late, you could be early, and your result is negative. That is because there are certain growth factors in uterus endometrium at the right time. So this window of implantation is what we need to catch, usually 4 to 5 days beginning after ovulation. So there is something known as ERA, is endometrial receptive test, ERA. When your cycles are failing, maybe one cycle you can just start the estradiol tablet, see the lining developing to 8 millimeter, and then start the progesterone injection at a particular time. 5 days later, your biopsy will be taken and sent, and we can find out whether it's the right time to transfer, or we should delay it, or we should do it an earlier transfer. Receptiva is a test nowadays available in the US where they find out the infection in the uterus, chronic endometritis, and it's a burning problem. We check that with the ultrasound and also on hysteroscopy. And if the women test positive, that is 5 times less likely to succeed in IVF than women testing negative. For embryos, we have the embryoscope. We can actually make out the morphokinetics of the embryo and find out the perfect grade of the embryo, which is good to be implanted. So this is the heart of incubator, is the heart of the IVF lab. Also, assisted hatching, advanced age frozen embryos can be given a nick with a laser and then transferred so that the embryo can be easily implanted into the uterine cavity. Now, there is an ongoing debate about optimal conditions for successful transfers. Per embryo implantation is just 50%. So should we transfer on day 3 or day 5? Should we transfer fresh versus frozen? So I said, now this is also individualized. Probably there are patients with low AMH and who have just 2 or 3 embryos. We would prefer a day 3 transfer. Fresh transfer is also good. It's nothing like all should go for frozen transfer. Not all should go for blastocyst transfer. But yes, preference, blastocyst transfer has a higher success rate. And blastocyst will happen in females who have more eggs. So in those, frozen will have a better egg. So as a protocol, don't go by a doctor who says that we only do frozen, we only do blastocyst. We have to individualize according to the patient. There are many patients with just 4 or 5 eggs and getting 3 good embryos with giving a result. If a progesterone, everything was under the control during the stimulation. So that also you should decide and discuss with the doctor that where do I stand and what is the best for me. If your first cycle is fresh and you didn't get a result and your frozen embryos are there, naturally second time frozen. Frozen day 3, thaw for 2 hours. Frozen blastocyst, thaw for 2-3 hours. Or frozen day 3, which are allowed to go to day 4 or day 5 and then you transfer, has a better result. Luteal phase support, yes. Progesterone is needed. You can take intramuscular injection, which will maintain the level. Sometimes they are painful or you don't have people to administer, but at least take twice a week, then go for, along with it for vaginal pessaries. Then you have the beta HCG, which is also confusing. A faint line or a beta HCG report, which is just 60, 70, I would say up to 200, you can't consider it positive unless it's a regular rising titer by 1.5 times every alternate day. But if it declines, then definitely it's a chemical pregnancy. You can also detect the abnormality of the embryo by PGTA. And if there is a disease running in the family or you are diagnosed with chromosomal abnormality, we can do PGTM. And we have found out the papers that PGTA is very good for patients with advanced maternal age, repeated failures, and repeated recurrent miscarriages. This is only up to August 19. We have done a lot more embryos. We do this quite often now routinely. And you can see how many out of 1,477 embryos, we had 779 abnormal. So if we keep transferring 1-1 blastocyst, maybe how many times you would have ended abnormal embryo transfer, and that could result. So if you have failures, even if you are young, you can ask for a PGTA testing on the blastocyst. PGTM is only for this certain group of patients where they have a family disease, and we have done all these cases and many more. Holistic approach, your egg that will be recruited, your sperm that will be recruited is a 60 to 70 days process. So 2 months prior, start having a healthy diet, lifestyle, exercise, sleep pattern, less stress, and even acupuncture. Slow down, keep calm, be positive, take it easy, unplug, which is very important, enjoy life, have fun, breathe and relax, go outside, meditate. More FAQs like to rest, not to rest, what precautions, do's and don'ts, what to eat, maybe next session. But yes, 2 tips to overcome is your failure is, first is a positive thought. Forget that negative cycle, leave it behind. Do everything best you can with your doctor, team and embryologist for the next cycle. Holistically, you should approach it. Choose a proper clinic for treatment, whereas advanced technologies. Go for personalized, customized IVF. Never compare your journey with others. Always hope for the best, but yes, be prepared for the worst. When you align with nature, good things happen. Thank you.